Hello and welcome to episode 36 of the Bearded Banter Podcast, the gaming podcast where, for the first time in almost two fucking years, my co-host Random Richard is back on the show.
I gotta say, it is good to be back here, man. What was the last time we did an episode? You said what day?
June 23rd,
2014. Fucking.
That was when we did the big one with us, Joe, Nick, and other Nick.
Both Nicks. I remember that one. Yeah, anyway, that was a lot of fun.
So it was good to be back. It was also a long time ago. That's because that was around the time I had just gotten Elgato, and the Let's Play stuff was the highest quality it had been at that point, so I wanted to focus more on that instead of having to worry about putting out a podcast every week. So I put that on hiatus. The show's been gone for a couple years, but just last week, we brought the show back. Me and Bones did a pilot episode for the new Bearded Banter, and now this week, we got the old crew back together. I am your host, the Bearded One, and with me is my co-host, Random Richard.
Fuck, it's good to be back.
And we're going to talk about some games like we always do on Bearded Banter. If you're not familiar with our show format, basically every episode we have minimum half an hour of general gaming discussion where we talk about what games we've been playing, systems we've gotten, just whatever we want to talk about in terms of gaming. And then after at least half an hour, sometimes the discussion goes longer than that, but at least after half an hour minimum, we move into some gaming-related news stories that I found were interesting over the past week, and we share our opinions on them. So, if my co-host is ready.
Yeah, I got my popcorn ready, so.
You got your snacks, you got a drink, you're comfy, you're ready to go, you're ready to do this.
Yep, I'm rocking out with my cock out, so we're all good.
So am I.
Anyway, oh, hello.
So, let's get this shit going!
Fuck yeah.
Discussion starts now. So, Riley.
Yes.
A lot has happened since the last episode that we did together. It's been almost 2 years, and both of us have done a lot in terms of gaming, aka we both gotten like new consoles.
We both have. What I have a PS4 now, so
yeah,
what do
you got
have?
A PS4 this past Christmas. I got an Xbox One the Christmas 2014, and then I also got a Wii U this past Christmas 2015.
Holy dog shit. So we essentially have the trifecta here.
I mean, if I had a PS4 of my own, it'd be like the Triforce of the current generation. But together, we have all three of the current generation systems, at least until next March, when the NX comes out.
Oh, yeah. That's actually one thing I have scratched down on my
little
list.
Why Nintendo? Yeah, we talked about it last week when the news came out. And
I got a few things to say.
Nintendo. You can go right ahead if you want.
Let's save that for a little bit.
It's probably going to be a big topic. So let's just start the episode talking about what we've been doing in terms of gaming, what we've been playing lately. Riley, what have you been playing lately?
Oh man. Well, basically, also between that, I got a PS3 for myself.
Yeah, I was there last summer.
Yes,
we got your own PS3.
Yeah, and I still have it. Things still works beautifully. Mostly
it was a slim, right?
Yeah, it's a slim.
It wasn't a super slim. It was just a regular slim. No, okay.
Well, super slims are kind of shit.
I have the super slim, man.
The disc tray, my friend,
I know, the top loader is kind of weird, but you get used to it.
Okay, well, I guess, whatever. I guess whatever works.
But anyway, what have you been playing lately then?
Okay, well, first off on the PS3, I just sort of started replaying all the games. I got back into Red Dead Redemption again, which, I've already talked about how much I love that game.
So much. And I'm right there with you.
Sorry?
And I'm right there with you.
And the fact that we might have a sequel coming out is enough to make my penis get really erect right now.
Unfortunately, that story came out before we brought the show back, so we haven't actually talked about it. But yeah, there was a supposed leak of a supposed world map for a possible Red Dead Redemption 2. And this game has been talked about for years. Like, the rumors have been speculating for years whether or not Rockstar is going to do another Red Dead Redemption.
Release it to PC.
Yeah, or release a PC port. And there was a bunch of talk not too long ago about them bringing it to Xbox One via backwards compatibility. That turned out to be false at the time, but never say never with backwards compatibilities, because like in the last like 3 days, they just released like 6 new games for it.
Which is good. I mean,
yeah, that's something I actually want to talk about, but we can do that a little later on.
Yeah. But okay, basically moving to PS4.
I've noticed it's a change. It's a fucking
new
generation.
Like, I don't have it. I just got it for Christmas, so I don't have a heck of a lot of games for it. The ones I have right now are The two games I have physical copies of are it's the Uncharted HD edition, which
The Nathan Drake collection.
Yes, which is what I got with
that actually PS4. Came on a physical disc.
Yeah,
I would have thought like at least nowadays when like you get a console bundle with a game, it would have been digital.
Which it did with The Last of Us, actually, so I have that as well.
Yeah, The Last of Us Remaster is always digital, but I'm surprised that they put a physical copy in that.
I know, me too. It probably drove up the price a little bit, but...
Yeah, it just doesn't seem like something they would do nowadays, you know?
Like, make a voucher for it. Like, that would have made more sense, but...
It would have made more sense. I'm not complaining about the disc, but, like, it seems to be the industry trend that whenever games are included with a system bundle, it's digital now.
I know, like,
which I get it. It brings down production costs. You know, it's more efficient. It's more convenient. But still, you know, people like me who are looking at the shelf from across the room, it's all neat and tidy and looks nice. I'm like, I'd like to put that on the shelf.
I know, right? And if you're like me, like I used to be the kind of person who likes games on their shelves. Right now, I'm looking at mine right now, and honestly, I've become a little more financially, I guess, conscious lately. So. If I see a good deal on PSN, I'm taking it. So
yeah, the whole idea of having... I don't blame you there. There's a lot of good deals on the Xbox Marketplace, too.
I got Tomb Raider for $8.
Yeah, I didn't get Tomb Raider for that cheap, too. I got Tomb Raider for $15 physically on Amazon.
Okay. Well, that's still not too bad.
Yeah, it was a pretty good deal. And then again, I also got Ghosts for the same price.
You got Ghosts.
That was a bad investment. That was a terrible game.
I'm done.
No, you come back here, motherfucker. You don't leave me to do this show on my own, you son of a bitch.
I'm sorry. I tried to give Ghosts the benefit of the doubt, but
I tried to. Like, the only reason I got Ghosts was because A, it's $15, so steal.
Why not?
And B, I played Advanced Warfare and I actually liked it.
Eh. Like I will agree it was okay, but
that's the first COD game since probably the original Black Ops that I've actually sat down and actually really enjoyed all the way through.
I still go
back to it every now and then and I play it online and it's still just as good. It's different from the other COD games. Like the main reason I got out of COD to begin with was because not so much the campaigns, it's more so the people. Like the campaigns have always been really high quality, really entertaining, really fun to play through. It's just after a while when you go online, there's manipulators, there's exploiters that just don't care about having fun. They care about winning, and that ruins the experience for everyone else, myself included. That's why I've become so cynical of COD lately, but it seems Advanced Warfare was a different case. It seems people didn't do that. They didn't go out of their way to blatantly exploit the system for their own benefit. It's like, I can still go on. I could go on right now and play it and have a lot of fun with it like I did the first time I played it, and people don't ruin it for me.
Maybe and that's it's because, yeah.
And that's what really brought me back to Call of Duty was that game, because A, it was super fun. B, it was something different. Granted, it was still Call of Duty, but they did enough things different where it felt like something fresh. And C, people aren't being assholes with it. So that's why I came back. So I thought, maybe I've been too harsh. Maybe I've been too critical of Call of Duty. Maybe I should go back because I like Advanced Warfare so much. Go back and see if some of the other games that I skipped over are worth my time. So I got Ghosts for Xbox One for $15 on Amazon. It's not a good game.
I did not care for Ghosts. I mean, I think the only reason that people aren't screwing around with Advanced Warfare is because maybe Kevin Spacey will come to their house and kill them.
Well, I mean, if he does it House of Cards style.
Yep. You know what I'm talking about.
If he does it House of Cards style, I mean, fuck, man. I'm not dealing with that shit.
I am definitely not getting into a car with him after having a couple drinks.
But, yeah. So I went back and I played Ghosts, and Ghosts was just not good. Like, it was just not good.
I have to agree.
Everything I've been saying about Call of Duty for years was, like, manifested in that single game. Even the campaign was shit. And most of the time, the campaigns aren't shit. Then again, you said Black Ops 2 was shit, but I never played that.
It depends on the person. Like, I personally didn't like it, but I'd say you give it a shot.
Yeah. And, I went back and played Ghosts, and it was not good. It was not good at all. I ended up getting rid of it.
I don't blame you.
But I kept Advanced Warfare because that's actually fun.
which is cool. I don't know. I personally have gotten burnt out with shooters. Like, I don't know. Like, just when I played Advanced Warfare, and I'm just like, eh.
And like, I'm still just as into shooters as I was back then. Like, I just recently got, a couple months ago, Halo 5.
How is it?
Xbox. It's great. It's a great game. Like, unfortunately, there's no co-op. There's no local co-op at all in the game, which is unfortunate. And the reason behind that is kind of bullshit. But still, like, I'm the kind of person, like, when it comes to Halo, I can play it by myself just fine, and I can play it with people just fine, because usually I play it with Taylor, my sister, and we play through every Halo campaign together, co-op, and we've had a lot of fun with it. Obviously, I have more fun playing it with someone else than myself, but I'm the kind of person, like, the experience isn't ruined for me if I play by myself, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I can still have just as much fun on my own than with people. But someone like my sister, who all of her enjoyment in Halo comes from playing with me, like, Halo 5 is ruined for her. She's even said it on the show. She will not play Halo 5 because of that.
Which is really stupid. I mean, that's what Halo is known for.
Exactly. And, like, the reason behind it is kind of stupid. They said that they can't do local split screen because they don't want to hinder the graphics.
Bullshit.
Because they said the game runs at 1080p, 60 frames per second, which it does. The game looks fucking beautiful. The reason they don't want to do split screen is because they would compromise that. And they think that in this generation, that adds so much more to the experience than people think. So they cut out split screen altogether because they knew it would hinder the frame rate. And they didn't want to do that.
I don't know about you. Like, I will admit, a game in 60 frames per second looks amazing. But
like, yeah.
If it drops a little bit, I'm fine.
I'm fine with that. Like,
I will. Chances are I won't notice.
And there's a bit of hypocrisy in their statement, too, because you can do that in the Master Chief Collection.
It's like when you have to bullshit an essay for school, you know? You just have to put something down.
Yeah. Like, they did it in their own game. Like, obviously, the Master Chief Collection, it's like an anthology of the four main Halo games on Xbox One. Remastered, 60 frames, 1080p, all that crap. You can go online split screen on the Master Chief Collection and get 1080p, 60 frames, no problem. But you can't do it in Halo 5, which is a way more graphically advanced game. Fucking Halo 2, not like remastered Halo 2, but regular ass Halo 2 can do that, but Halo 5 can't.
Because go fucking figure, I guess.
It just seems like utter bullshit.
That was really stupid. I don't know. I was watching like everyone reacting to that and going like, what the fuck are you guys doing?
I really hope that they bring that back for Halo 6.
I really
hope they do.
One game I want to address that's always kept that and will always continue to do that, the Lego games. And I also want to give them another prop. They've been better movie-based versions of games than the actual licensed video games of movies.
Yeah.
And this is coming off of playing Lego Jurassic World, which
I knew you were going to talk about that.
I'm sorry. I love the Jurassic Park series, so getting to see all the characters in Lego and getting to play through the movies like very accurately, actually.
I can't remember. No, you and I didn't go see Jurassic World.
We did not.
We did not go see Jurassic World. We went and saw Mad Max.
We did, yes. That was awesome.
Yeah, we saw Fury Road, which, oh my god, that movie.
Oh, that movie really grew on me. Like,
I just watched it again recently, and I forgot how fucking good that movie is.
And all that is real. Like, there's a few...
I know, it's like, there's a little bit of CG here and there, mostly in the Desert Storm sequence. It's pretty apparent. But most of that is practical. And I applaud George Miller. Like, way to fucking go, buddy.
I know. Like, even if you watch the original ones, like, from the 70s, they're really campy, and they have an impossibly young Mel Gibson, but they're still good.
They're still good, yeah. But, like, Fury Road's so good. Like,
oh.
God fucking damn it. I wish they would make a video... Wait. I was gonna say, I wish they would make a video game of that, but they kind of already did.
How is it?
It's pretty good. I actually really like it. Like, think of, like, GTA... In the desert, if all the combat was based around the vehicles. Shut up. Why'd you have to bring that up?
I don't know.
Ah, oh, you asshole. But yeah, Mad Max, solid game. Like, that's I got it on sale for $40, well worth the price.
Well, if I ever see it go down in price, I'll get it.
So wait, what else have you been playing lately?
Oh, man. Okay. I want to talk about a game on the PS4 that is...
I think I know what you're going to talk about. But
Firewatch.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Firewatch. Okay, it was like $19. I thought, okay, why not? Watched the trailer, liked it, played the game. Oh my God, it's good.
Well, it's an indie game. What do you expect?
Yes, and it has, I forget who the guy's name is, but the main guy, Henry, is voiced by somebody from Mad Men. I forget the actor's name. Can you find it out and put it in text at the bottom?
Yeah, I'll look it up later and put it on the video. Boom, this is the guy.
Okay, cool, because I totally fucking forget right now, and I am way too lazy to look it up.
I know exactly who you're talking about, because one of my professors just will not shut up about Mad Men.
I work in advertising. How do you think I get?
Yeah, like one of my profs, like, I love him. He's one of my favorite profs. Every fucking chance he gets, he references Mad Men, and people have started at the university to make memes about it.
We've done stuff like that. We've done that. I got a couple funny stories to tell you at some point.
But anyway, continue.
I'm eating. Fuck.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, basically.
Slob.
I am a slob. Like, I had my room cleaned yesterday, and Alice came over yesterday, and now it's a fucking disaster. Either way, I digress. Yeah, basically, and it's a really good game. It's set in Wyoming in the 80s, and you play Henry, whose wife is diagnosed with Alzheimer's, so he needs an escape.
Oh, great.
And so he decides to go be a fire watch in Shoshone National Park in Wyoming. And this is 89. Like, they reference it. Like, the music. They reference Ronald Reagan. Of course, I have to. By the way. Not the president. Back to the Future joke. And, yeah, so it's a really good game. It's the environments are beautiful. It's, like, cel-shaded, but not.
Yeah, I've seen the trailers. The visual style is actually really cool.
Like, it looks realistic, but at the same time, it looks like it was done by somebody, like, using ink and paint or something like that. It's really hard to describe. You have to actually play it for yourself.
It's like watercolor, almost. It's like that smooth kind of... I know exactly what you're talking about. It's not completely cel-shaded. Like, there's no outlines on everything, but it looks like a really in-depth, like, cartoon, almost.
That's the best way to describe it.
It's got that cartoony vibe to it, where the colors really pop, and everything has like a stylized look to it.
And another interesting thing I know, at the PS4 controller, it has the lights on the back, right?
Yeah.
So if if you're carrying a torch, I've noticed that Tomb Raider does this as well. It'll flash like yellow and red. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh wow, that's cool.
Yeah, and the Xbox One doesn't have that on their controller, so...
It's only because I was playing it at night that I noticed that, so yeah. I was like, sweet. But yeah, I love Firewatch. It's a game mostly based around dialogue. Like,
I've seen videos of it, yeah.
The story doesn't change, but how your relationship with...
other characters?
I forget. Delilah, the other person in the other Firewatch in the other area.
The female Firewatch. Like,
yeah, who you never see, but you only constantly talk to through a walkie-talkie. Mm-hmm. And it's your interaction with her is based on sort of how you respond to certain questions that she asks you, and how do you respond to certain conversational things. The story itself doesn't change, and I'm not going to spoil anything about the story because it's actually a relatively short game. So
yeah, I've heard it's only like 3-4 hours.
You could beat it in 6 if you take your time. But it's still a fun game. Like, I gladly play it again. I think it's worth the money.
Yeah, but then again, like, you kind of expect a shorter game when it comes to an indie game, right?
Yeah, I'm not expecting like a 20-hour, like a 50-hour game. Like,
no.
I'm not expecting that at all. But like, you know, But yeah, so I really enjoyed Firewatch. I would highly recommend it. It's only on PS4.
If I had a PS4, I would totally buy it.
When you come over, I can show it to you. It's actually a short game, so I can probably show you. I could probably show you it a little.
You could probably show you me a decent chunk of it, yeah.
Oh yeah, just let you play it.
Let's see, what have I been playing lately?
Also, off topic real fast, I am so used to the PS4 controller that going back to the PS3 is weird.
Yeah, the PS3 controller isn't my favorite controller. It still feels weird in my hands sometimes. It still feels oddly light.
Yeah, well, you're always used to Xbox, so.
Yeah, like I played on a PS4 before because a couple of my friends have PS4s, and the DualShock 4, amazing controller. Like, it feels great in your hands. And then going back to playing a PS3 game, it's like, is there anything in this shell?
I know. I was thinking that. Like, I decided to play Lego Marvel Super Heroes just because I was bored as fuck, and I thought, hey, I haven't played the PS3 in a while, so I'm playing it. And I'm going like, oh my god, this is fucking weird here, man. What is this?
It's like, I feel like I could snap this in half if I really wanted to.
I felt like I probably could if I had the chance.
If I had if I put the effort into it, I could probably snap one of those. Then again, I'd be down one PS3 controller.
Well, I've already fixed a broken one before, so.
Yeah, but like literally snapping it in half, duct tape won't fix that.
Duct tape will fix anything. Sorry, I've been watching
The Martian. Don't believe what Red Green tells you, okay?
Oh, hey, you do not diss our childhood like that.
I know, but still, it's like duct tape doesn't fix everything. I'm sorry.
Okay, it fixes 99% of things. And also, sorry, I've been watching The Martian a lot, so.
I still haven't seen that movie.
And I actually been reading the book. The book's really good.
Oh, okay.
And this is from a guy who hasn't read a novel since, like, high school.
Dude, I don't remember the last time I read a book fully.
Well, I watched
I didn't even read Life of Pi all the way through. I just bullshit my way through that final essay.
It's okay. That's 90%. Actually, that's every high school essay I've ever done.
But then I watched the movie, and the movie was pretty solid.
Really? Yeah. I haven't seen it yet. I still want to.
It's on Netflix, so.
Okay, I'll have to give that one a shot. I'm looking forward to that.
Has there anything else you've been playing particularly in the past, like, week or so?
Well, not in the past week or so, but have you played... I know this is kind of an older game now, but I've been playing Second Son, Infamous.
Infamous, okay.
It's fun. Like, yeah, I've never played any of the Infamous games.
Yeah, I played it, and it's a lot of fun. It's probably my favorite Infamous, and then again, I haven't played much of the other two, but...
I will say one thing about this game. The one thing about Seattle that they nailed was having a coffee shop every 20 feet. Seriously, Seattle is exactly like that.
It has a very hipster vibe to it.
Yeah. Like, it's always sort of raining, and always, like, the weather's kind of shitty a little bit. And I haven't beaten it yet, but...
Have you played First Light?
No.
Okay. I play both of them. Okay, not all the way through. I've just delved in them a little bit. But basically, First Light is, like, a shorter... It's basically Second Son if it was shorter and you only had the neon power. It's still really good, but just that's the only power you have.
I'll give that one a shot. I mean, I do want to get into the Infamous series, so I mean, because I was really impressed.
I have the first two on PS3, so
holy shit.
I could bring them over at some point.
Yeah, that'd be fun. I like that. And oh my god, the PS3 is kind of almost collecting dust at this point.
I've actually been playing the PS3 a lot more lately. Which, going into what I've been playing lately, I've been playing Ratchet and Clank again.
I think we all know why.
Well, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Have you seen the movie?
No, not yet.
Oh, I haven't either. So.
I've heard a lot of mixed things about it, though.
It's one of those movies you either like it or hate it.
I'm still gonna see it at some point, though. Because Ratchet and Clank.
I mean, yeah. So
here's the thing. I've heard that the game is fucking amazing.
Yeah.
The movie's eh.
Well, no. At least it's not Super Mario Brothers.
True, that is very true.
Which I gave that one another watch a couple months ago just for shits and giggles.
Dude, why would you do that?
Fuck. Okay, have you ever heard of CinemaSins?
Yeah.
Oh my god, he has hilarious...
How many sins did they give that?
I don't know, but a lot.
A lot.
They gave, like, Fast and Furious 7, like, 1,000.
1,002. But, yeah, I've been playing Ratchet and Clank lately. Mostly because of the hype... of the new game and also the movie. I can't play the game, though, because I don't have a PS4, which, fuck.
Is it only a PS4 exclusive?
It's PS4 exclusive.
Yay.
Ratchet and Clank is a Sony exclusive franchise, so whatever comes out is only on PlayStation.
Yay.
Which is weird, because I've seen videos of it, and obviously it's like a reimagining of the first game, built from the ground up, and it looks, not in terms of graphics, but in terms of level design, like... Me being a hardcore Ratchet and Clank fan, playing the original games, that is the original game, like, all the way through. Like, I haven't seen all of it, obviously, but from what I've seen, the planets that you go to are the exact same design as they were in the original game. And, like, being a hardcore Ratchet and Clank fan, playing the original game, I watched the videos of the new one, and I'm like, holy shit, I remember that. Oh, I remember going down that side path and getting a gold bolt. I remember jumping over that pit, like... Fuck, I want to play it so bad.
Brings back memories, doesn't it?
It brings back a lot of memories. There's a lot of nostalgia behind it, but I've also heard that the game itself is actually really fucking good.
Well, if I see it go down in price, I'll probably get it. So
it's a budget title to begin with.
How much is it?
It's only $40 new.
Shit.
Yeah.
Ooh, I'm tempted. Although I am really the two games I'm hyped for right now would be Uncharted 4 and No Man's Sky. So.
Well, Uncharted 4. By the time this episode comes out, Uncharted 4 will already have come out.
Yeah, I know that. So. Yeah.
So.
We should address. It's like May 4th when we record this.
Yeah, I put a disclaimer at the beginning.
Like, okay.
We record episodes a week ahead of time, so I always put a timestamp.
Yeah. Okay. Good. So. Yeah, so
this was recorded on May 4th.
May the 4th be with you.
So everything we talk about in the news section will probably be out of date by next week, but hey, who cares?
It's like Apple phones.
Shut up, bitch.
You say as you hold up your iPhone.
Yeah, because I have an iPhone.
Me too. See that?
Yeah, I see it. I see that you. Logo. But yeah, so in terms of Ratchet and Clank specifically, I've been playing Tools of Destruction, which was the first game on the PS3.
Because, I remember the commercials for that.
Yeah. Because A, it's one of my favorites, and B, I'm actually thinking of playing it for the channel soon.
Give it a shot, I'd say. Maybe. You know, I think it'd look really good on the channel.
Maybe not anytime soon, but like later on. I'm thinking of playing like a few smaller games before I get to that. But yeah, the game's really fun. It's just as good as I remember it. Crack in Time is still my favorite, and it's still probably my favorite PS3 game.
Mm-hmm.
Tools of Destruction is still a really good game, and it's a really good start to that future series they did on the PS3. Yeah. It's a really good start to that new trilogy. Anything else I've been playing has been on Xbox, which it's been a lot of Halo 5. I've been playing a lot of multiplayer. I played Mad Max a little bit. I played some Dragon Ball here and there because Dragon Ball is like my go-to game. Dragon Ball Xenoverse specifically.
Yeah.
I've dabbed in Wii U. I've been playing a lot of Mario Kart 8 lately.
Like, which I haven't played.
I've been playing a lot of Mario Kart 8 online.
Oh, yeah. How is the online in comparison to...
It's better than Smash.
Okay, so that's already grounds here.
Remember Brawl on the Wii. Did you ever try and play that online?
By try, you mean gave up? Yes.
You mean basically play the game online. But
which went horribly.
It was horrible. I don't, like, just Brawl was not good online. It was always super laggy. It was always, it basically ruined Smash because of the lag.
I would have to agree.
But you would think, oh, with the Wii U, their new console, it's finally getting up to where the standards were, like, Microsoft and Sony have been in the last few years. Smash 4 online will be amazing.
Oh yeah, that'll be something else.
Not that much better, actually.
At least that's what people thought back.
Not that much better, because I don't know if it was just my internet, or if it was other people's internet, or if it was actually just the game servers.
Which you never know. Like
it's still playable, but there's still a noticeable amount of lag. It's not the best, but it's much better than Brawl.
So the fact that you can actually see your characters move is a big
yes,
one.
Yeah. But Mario Kart 8 Online it plays, like, beautifully. It plays seamlessly. No lag at all. Which, it was the same thing on the Wii. Mario Kart Wii was much better online and had no issues. And yeah. Brawl had all of them. Like, Brawl had all the issues, but Mario Kart didn't. It's the same thing on the Wii U. Smash 4, and again, I don't know if it's the game or if it's my or other people's connections.
But, I would argue it might be the game at this point. I mean,
but it's still laggy. It's still not perfect. And Mario Kart, on the other hand, is perfect. Like, seamless gameplay, no lag, nothing. So for the second console generation in a row, Mario Kart is better than Smash Online.
Go figure.
Go figure. But I've been playing a lot of Mario Kart lately because a friend of mine who also does Let's Plays started playing Mario Kart 8 on his channel, which we're going to have him on the show in a couple of weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Not the guy I was talking about earlier. That's coming
out
next.
Yeah.
But he'll be on in a couple weeks. Okay. And I think it'll be cool to hear, someone else's perspective on Let's Plays. Because, you know, you and me have been doing it a certain way for years. So hearing he's relatively new, actually. He just started a couple of weeks ago.
Really?
So he's basically a newbie when it comes to Let's Playing.
So you can show him the ropes a little bit.
Yeah, that's what I've been doing. He's been having issues lately, so I've been, you know, I've been giving him tips and hints and all that, and I've been helping him, giving him advice and stuff.
Okay.
So it'll be cool to hear a fresh perspective on Let's Playing from someone who's just gotten into it. I think they'll bring an interesting discussion with it.
Like a newbie perspective. Not trying to be a dick here, but like, you know.
So anyway, we're just getting up on half an hour in terms of general discussion. So let's quickly go over if you have any like topics you wanted to bring up, like any like specific topics you wanted to bring up.
For general discussion?
Yeah, for general discussion. I have like three here that I want to talk about, specific things. But if you have any, you can go ahead.
I'm good for right now, actually. So okay. If you want to go ahead.
Okay, well, I've been wanting to talk about something on the show. This past week, a friend of mine just got the new Fire Emblem.
Mm-hmm.
Fire Emblem Fates. And again, my friend, a different friend, who is the new Let's Player, he has been playing Fire Emblem Fates on his channel. And I've watched some episodes, and I just don't get it. Like, I get the game. Like, Fire Emblem is a strategy game, but here's what I wanted to talk about. Why do people like strategy games? Because I know I'm just speaking from my point of view, but personally, I don't find it interesting. I'm the kind of gamer who's very... I'd say I'm in the middle ground when it comes to patience. Like, when it comes to gameplay, I can play a slow game, I can play a fast game, but I prefer a fast game. A strategy game is a completely slow-paced game because, you know, it's a strategy game. You got to implement strategy. You got to think about your movements, your tactics. I've just never found strategy games all that interesting, other than a few instances of real-time strategy, mainly Brutal Legend.
Yeah.
That was the only, like, real-time strategy game, and I emphasize real-time strategy game, that I actually liked, because real-time strategy and regular strategy are two completely different things.
Okay.
Because, okay, like, your standard strategy is, like, you got characters on, like, plot points, and then you move them forward and you give them commands. Real-time strategy, you're actually on the battlefield controlling a character, and you're actually in the fight. That's the kind of strategy I like, which is why I like Brutal Legend. But
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but here's my question, and I want to get your opinion on this. Why do you think people find strategy games particularly interesting? Like, why are strategy games so popular?
My take on that is that people like to sort of exercise their minds a little bit. Like, people like to... Because video games can be kind of cut and dry. Like, you do one thing, you do another, you do one thing, you do another. Strategy games involves a little bit more thinking, and some people like to be puzzled that way.
But see, here's the thing. Again, this is just from my perspective. Not particularly liking strategy games. Why not play a puzzle game?
Different strokes for different folks, I guess.
It's completely up to interpretation, and it's completely based on, you know, people's opinions and tastes. But I personally have never found strategy games that interesting. If I want to, like, challenge myself, I'll play a puzzle game. Like, I'll play Portal, or I'll play Fez, or I'll play some kind of puzzle game that'll get my brain juices flowing. But I couldn't play a strategy game.
Like, and that's totally fine. I mean, they're not for everyone. Like...
And, like, I even talked to my friend who got the game, and I'm like, why do people find this interesting? Because I don't. And he's like, yeah, it's just based on opinion. So, like, if you like strategy games, it's perfectly fine. I'm just saying, from my personal point of view, I could care less.
Like, this is kind of one-sided, I guess, but, you know, yeah. Since...
But, like, it's like... I think mostly people find strategy games interesting because, you know, there are those certain niche audiences in gaming that like to think about every move they make in a game. So strategy games are like their perfect place to implement those tactics, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, because I have another friend, again, different from the other two friends I've already talked about, but he plays...
I'm losing track here, dude.
Yeah. He plays exclusively, from what I've seen, strategy games. So I think he's more in the mindset of this game. Again, it challenges me mentally. It makes me think about every little move that I have to make. And if I slip up once, that means failure.
Which I'm not a fan of.
Yeah, I think that's what people find interesting about strategy games is, you know, there's so much risk and not enough reward, but when you get that reward from taking that risk by, like, plotting out your movements, it feels rewarding.
Yeah, exactly.
That's why I personally think people like strategy games, but I'm just not a fan. Like, I get that from puzzle games, and I enjoy puzzle games way more.
Yeah, that was me with Metal Gear Solid 5. Like, I don't know. I particularly didn't care for Metal Gear Solid 5 that much because of, like...
Ground Zeroes or Phantom Pain?
Phantom Pain.
Okay.
Pain. I actually have not played Ground Zeroes, even though I know I should. But I don't know. It just, I know I'm going to get ripped apart for this.
Probably.
It's not the Metal Gear I remember it being.
Yeah, it's definitely changed.
Maybe even I'm though, just living in the past even, too much.
Even though most people praise the game for being a little different and changing things up a bit. But I will agree, it is a different game than it was.
It's a lot harder. Like, it's like definitely like slip up once and you're kind of screwed.
Fuck you, mate.
Yeah, basically. I will give it this. It had good David Bowie songs.
It did.
I know. Peace now, I'm sad. Fuck.
Ride that tiger of lightning.
Well, he's the star man now, so.
Yeah. So anyway, I just wanted to bring that up because I was like, I'm not much of a fan. Anyway, something else I want to talk about. We talked about Call of Duty a little earlier, and last week on the show, we talked about all the rumors that were surrounding the new Call of Duty that's coming this year from Infinity Ward, and basically, like, a few days before that episode comes out, which it comes out today, the day we're recording.
Yeah.
But basically, everything we talked about, all the rumors ended up being true. The game is called Call of Duty Infinite Warfare. It's coming out on November 4th. It comes with a remaster version of Call of Duty 4.
Which I might get just for that, if I'm honest.
We'll talk about that later on. But yeah, basically all the rumors we talked about last week on the show ended up being true. And pre-orders are now available. You can go and you can pre-order the game from whatever outlet you so desire. And that's what I want to talk about. Because I went on the Xbox Marketplace last night, and I might even record a little footage of the Marketplace and put it up on the screen. But when you go on your Xbox One and you go to the store, there's this big banner right at the top that says Call of Duty Infinite Warfare pre-order now. So you click on that, and it takes you immediately to the most expensive version, which, yeah. Marketing.
Well, you know, it's just like, oh, Call of Duty. I don't care if it's expensive. I'll buy it. I have money.
But anyway, so you go there, and it takes you to the Digital Deluxe Edition, which is like $130. So you cancel out of that, and you're like, well, I just want to look at the Standard Edition. So you go in the Xbox store, you find the Standard Edition, and usually it shows the title at the top, the cover right below that, and right below that, there's a price, right?
Yeah.
There is no price.
Which is a bad sign.
There is no price for the standard edition of Infinite Warfare. It just says bundle only. And I'm like, wait, what? So I click on that. And it turns out, and I don't know if this is just a mishap on Microsoft's side of things, but on the Xbox One Marketplace, you cannot buy the standard definition of Infinite Warfare digitally. You have to buy one of the more expensive bundles.
What in the fuck?
Yeah, because you go into the store, you find the standard edition, and where there would be a price, it just says bundle only. You click on that, and it takes you to the other two bundles, the Legacy Edition and the Digital Deluxe. So right now, at least, you cannot buy the standard edition of Infinite Warfare digitally on Xbox.
Which is really goddamn stupid.
The cheapest edition you can buy, the Legacy Edition, is $110.
I don't know about you. I don't exactly have $110 to be spending on that right now.
What do you think about this?
Fuck that.
And again, I don't know if it's just a mishap on Microsoft's side of things right now. I'll have to go back and check. But right now, it seems that on Xbox One, you cannot buy the standard edition of Infinite Warfare digitally. You have to buy at least the Legacy Edition. What do you think of that?
That's like extortion.
It really
is. If you ask me. Like, plain and simple, that's extortion. Like, why the hell would you do that? Like,
I'm like, I'm most likely going to go and record some footage and put it up to show everyone.
Can you do that, please? I think people need to see that.
I will. So,
I will actually check about PSN.
Yeah, please do that and let me know. Because I don't know if it's just Xbox or if it's every digital outlet right now.
Yeah, like,
I don't know. Like, that's just something I wanted to talk about because I'm like, okay, A, that's bullshit. B, that's overpricing the game. Like, if you don't want one of these more expensive standard editions, but you're only looking to buy the game digitally, you got to suck it up.
you're kind of shit out of luck then, which is really
so
stupid.
Either you have to go out and buy a physical copy, or you have to suck it up and buy at least the Legacy Edition. So give us $110, please, if you even want to play this game.
This is my response to that.
Yeah, fuck that.
I don't know if you're going to be putting the video up.
I'm not putting the video up. He just shot the middle finger at the camera.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah,
but,
I can't confirm this.
It might get a ton of shit and do it too.
It might get a ton of shit. It might change soon. It might just be an error on Microsoft's end. I don't know. This is just what I found last night when I was surfing the Xbox store. And I don't get it. Like, if Call of Duty, like, okay, first off, if Call of Duty is that big, like, why haven't they been doing this for years? Secondly, is this game that good? Is this game going to be that good to warrant at least $110 base price?
Probably not.
Even though the trailer looked promising, and
I will admit, I am
anticipating the space combat aspect.
Hopefully it's not just like a thing they use in one mission.
Yeah, hopefully. And like,
even though we all know it will.
And like, I've been watching videos of other YouTubers reacting to the trailer, and they've been saying like the space combat looks promising, but it's basically general consensus among most gaming YouTubers. They want to see space combat and multiplayer. They want to see dogfighting in space in multiplayer. And that's something that would be so distinctly different from the COD we're used to. It would get a ton of attention. People would be going out and buying the shit like hotcakes, which they're already going to. But even more so.
You put the Call of Duty logo on something and people will buy it in droves.
Like Call of Duty Big Red 1. Which so I never played, but I heard it was terrible.
Call of Duty sponsored dildo.
Yeah. So yeah, that's what I just found. What are your final thoughts on that, Riley?
That's extortion.
It is extortion.
I'm pretty sure that might be somewhat illegal. If it's not illegal, it's just a dick move.
It is just a very dick move.
Which, I don't know about you, I mean, I am not buying that.
Like, just the kind of gamer I am, I would be going out to get the physical copy anyway, which is, you know, your standard game price, $80. So I don't have to worry about this, but people who are so stubborn that I have to buy it digitally, I can't buy it any other way. You kind of shit out of luck on Xbox, it seems. If you can't buy the standard edition digitally, you're shelling out $110 at the least. And that's not a good sign.
Not really. Like,
and like, what do you get in this Legacy edition that warrants $110? Well, you get Modern Warfare Remastered, and you get a few little DLC items for $30 more. Then again, Modern Warfare Remastered would probably be $30 on its own.
Mm-hmm.
Still, I don't get it. But it's going
stupid. That's literally all I have to say about it. It's fucking stupid.
But going off of that, I have one last discussion thing to talk about before we go into our news stories. I've been playing again. I forgot to mention this earlier. I've been playing Sunset Overdrive again.
Yeah.
Which the game's amazing. If you haven't played it yet and you have an Xbox One, go get it. It's actually free on Xbox One right now.
Dicks.
Because it was part of last month's Games with Gold. It's still free. Go get it if you haven't played it yet. It is definitely worth your time. Also, the week we're recording this, the Deals with Gold, the Sunset Overdrive Season Pass was $10.
Mm.
So I downloaded it, and it comes with Season Pass exclusive content. It comes with a weapons pack, and it comes with two DLC campaigns.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I played through the DLC last night, and I know we've talked about DLC a lot on the show in the past, but I have to talk about this. It seems like, and it's not all DLC. It's a very rare case when a DLC is actually pretty lengthy, but like the Sunset Overdrive DLCs, not even 2 hours.
That's
like I played the first one, which was the mystery of the Mo oil rig, and yeah, it was about an hour and a half, I would say, to get through all the main story missions.
Which is, that's a ripoff. How much did you pay for it?
Well, I paid $10 for all of
it. Fuck that.
I paid $10 for two campaign DLCs and a bunch of DLC weapons, when it's normally like 25.
Oof.
And I believe both of the campaigns on their own are $10 individually. I don't think I would pay $10 for an hour and a half.
No, unless you go to Amsterdam.
Yeah. Then again, I did pay. People did pay $20 for Journey, and that game is only an hour and a half too.
So
Journey's a different case though, because
it's a different kind of game.
Yeah, which... Journey. It's an indie game. It's meant to be an emotional experience. It's meant to enthrall you in terms of its visuals, its sound design, its underlying themes. You know, it's a different experience than Sunset Overdrive, which is just batshit crazy, go out and fuck shit up.
Like Firewatch, like it's an emotional. Well, yeah, I'd say it's an emotional experience, but like you know what I mean.
Yeah. So, like, it's just, I don't know about you, but it seems like most DLCs nowadays, when they talk about story DLC, the story DLCs are pretty fucking short.
Which is, I think it's because they know they're going to get their money out of it.
Probably. Like, another example of this is Batman Arkham Knight. And I don't know if you played Arkham Knight yet.
I have not.
Okay. Well.
I have not had the time.
Well, they have these, what they call Arkham episodes, which are these tiny little mini campaigns where you play as different characters. Yeah. And, well, when I got the game, first off, Arkham Knight was one of my most anticipated games of last year. I fucking pre-ordered that game, and I very rarely pre-order games. That's how much I was anticipating that game. And the moment I got it, I also bought the season pass, which is $40.
Really?
But it comes with a bunch of shit, so it more than makes up for it.
Okay, so it makes up for the money then. Okay.
Yeah, the season pass is $40, but it comes with a bunch of character skins for Batman and other characters. It comes with a bunch of challenge mode maps. It comes with a bunch of Batmobile racetracks. It comes with a bunch of skins for the Batmobile itself. And then it comes with a bunch of little story campaigns featuring different characters like Robin, Nightwing, Catwoman, all that crap. The DLCs themselves, the story DLCs, the Arkham episodes, are extremely short. Like, I remember I was playing, I just bumped my elbow off the table. Fuck.
I heard that. Like, ow.
Fuck me. Ow.
Oh, man, I heard that. That sounded brutal.
This is how much effort I put into BGN content. I physically injure myself.
He hurts himself for your pleasure. God, yeah, that sounds
but,
weird.
Oh, God. Don't go there. But yeah, so when the game first came out, you got, if you pre-ordered the game, you got an Arkham episode featuring Red Hood. And if you just bought the game normally, you got Harley Quinn's little episode. So two little mini DLC episodes with Harley Quinn and Red Hood. Both of them, like, individually, they were both about half an hour each. And I'm like... that seems criminally short for something like that, but maybe, you know, when they release the DLC later on, when the game is actually out for a while, they won't be that short. They'll put more time and effort into it, make them longer, because the first few DLCs that came out weren't developed by Rocksteady. They were developed by someone else.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, this is tolerable. Sure, they're short, but I'm sure the other ones won't be as short. The rest of them weren't much longer, and there were like 8 of them that came out. There was the one with Red Hood, one with Harley Quinn, one with Batgirl, one with Robin, one with Nightwing, one with Catwoman, and I believe there was another one that I'm missing. But yeah, most of them on average are half an hour.
Which
if they're part of the season pass, I've already paid $40 for it, and I'm already getting a lot more content other than that. So sure, that's justifiable. I'm not exactly sure how much they sell individually. I think they're like $8 a piece. Would you pay $8 for like 20, 30 minutes?
No.
That's my point.
Fuck that.
That's my point. It seems like a lot of DLC nowadays is going this route where they're being... the price is overinflated and there's not much content. What do you think about this?
Which I hate. Which if I'm paying $20 for something, I want to be able to at least get 5 hours out of it. That's my set number. 5 hours. Okay. Like Firewatch is a very replayable game, so I'll give it that. But, you know, if I don't want to like just pay $20 for something, play it for an hour and a half and just be then have nothing else to do with it, and like it's just like, what the fuck, I don't want to play this again now, like this is stupid, like it's a waste of my time if you ask me. I am the person who wants to get their money's worth. So
and it just seems like the industry is going more down this route than ever before,
which I don't like.
Seems like DLCs are getting shorter and shorter, but the prices keep getting higher and higher.
It's like it's It's not even worth it to get DLC anymore.
Again, this isn't every instance of DLC. Like, a good example of a game developer that doesn't do this is CD Projekt Red, the people who made Witcher 3. The DLCs for those games are just as long as, like, they're like 10 hours each. Like,
which is a good length for a DLC. Like
I know the first of the two main story DLCs for Witcher 3 is already out, which my sister has. She told me that it's like 10-12 hours, and it was like $20,
which is almost the length of a standard game now. I feel, well, not everyone obviously, but
not everyone, but you know,
kind of becoming that way.
The price is more than justifiable if you're getting that much content. And I heard the second expansion that's coming out, Blood and Wine, is just as long, maybe longer. So,
yeah, so,
it isn't every instance of DLC where it's criminally short but criminally expensive. It's just most instances. There are a few rare cases where the DLC has a plethora of content for a much lower price than normal.
Yeah.
But it's not the standard. It's not the norm, which I don't like. I obviously don't like it because even though I love Arkham Knight and I got more than my money's worth out of that game, I can be the first one to say that you should not buy those DLCs. Like, don't even bother. You're not missing anything.
There's literally no point. I mean, if the content is that short, why do it? Just, like, compile them all together. Like, I know profit-wise you make more money afterwards, but you know what? Like,
fuck it.
I get it. Companies have to make money, and times
are tough. Companies have to make money, and they don't feel that... Like, DLC is just an exploit to get more money out of the player at this point.
Yeah.
Like, they don't feel like their game can do well enough on its own, so they have to pump out these additional downloadable content packs to get more money. Like, if you had faith in your game, you wouldn't... DLC would be an afterthought if you had faith in your game.
But the fact that they make 90%, like, a good amount of the game you have to download afterwards as an afterthought, like, that's...
They clearly they don't have enough faith in their games to sell well enough on their own.
I get it. Sometimes DLCs can be good, like, if it's, like, cool ideas afterwards, but...
DLCs can be really enjoyable sometimes.
Yeah, it's like, just, we give it a lot of flack, but...
Yeah, we give it a lot of flack. It's just, most of the time, it seems like DLCs are thought of more than the actual game. That's a huge issue.
Well, then again, I guess, you know, from a profit point of view, you know, if somebody buys a game for, like, what, 60, 70 bucks or whatever, 80 after tax here?
70, 80 nowadays.
After tax, and you have to include tax and stuff like that. So after that, that's it. You don't get any more. So you want to find ways to get more money out of them. So, like, let's say a game is 60, 70 after tax.
Okay.
And the DLC is $20 or, like,
after tax, because 30. Because most digital outlets have tax, other than PlayStation, which, fuck PlayStation.
My purchases do not have tax.
Yeah. I know.
So if I buy something for $19.99, I buy it for $19.99.
I know, because I have a PS3 too. I wish all of the digital stores did that, but I digress.
Because it's because we live in Ontario, and taxes are insane here.
Yeah.
Like, you go to other places in this country and it's different, but Ontario's
like Alberta.
Really, oh God, Alberta. It depends.
Anyway, continue.
We have like 13% here. It's fucking stupid.
Yeah, it's stupid.
Yeah. So I just think that DLC is generally becoming kind of like a piss fly or something.
Yeah. Like, I think if game developers and game publishers had enough faith in their games to sell on their own, DLC would be an afterthought, like it was when it first started. It wouldn't be a core part of the game that you sell after the fact.
Yeah.
And like I said, with the Sunset Overdrive DLC, with the Batman Arkham Knight DLCs, they're criminally short for probably too much money. And I think something needs to change there, but it probably won't.
Well, who knows? Maybe some good developers will make some good stuff for DLC, or just not do it at all. Like
CD Projekt Red.
Yeah, them.
Like, they're a good example of doing DLC properly.
But
anyway, I think that's the last point I have to talk about for general discussion. So yeah. We went kind of long with the discussion here.
How long did we go?
52 minutes.
Fuck.
So
that file's going to be a bitch.
We talked a lot. We're going to wrap up the discussion here, and we're going to move into some gaming news stories that happened in the past week that I found interesting that I would like to share opinions on. So, Riley, if you're ready, I'm going to start.
Okay.
Okay, there's a lot of Call of Duty news about Infinite Warfare, obviously, because it's just been announced. We're going to save that for the end. So to start off, we have a new story here. As reported by IGN, Nolan North is making a game.
Nolan North, eh?
Nolan North is making a game. The article reads, Nathan Drake voice actor Nolan North is making a mobile game based on his comedy series Con Men. According to Eurogamer, North will be a producer on the game with Canadian studio Freema handling development. Con Men is a series starring Nathan Fillion and Alan Tudyk, which which went through a successful Indiegogo campaign before airing on Vimeo and On Demand. In the show, Nolan North plays mocap king Jerry Lansing. This is a quote from Nolan North himself. It was a character of my own doing, just goofing around as Troy Baker and I were talking. Jerry Lansing. I'm bringing him to life, and we've just been picked up for season two, so that's shooting in June. So yeah, basically, Nolan North is making a game based on a television series that he stars in. What do you think about this, Riley? Keep in mind, it is a mobile game.
Well, I don't know. I know mobile games are huge right now, but I haven't really delved in that in the past 5 years or so. Like, yeah. I don't even have any games on my phone.
Not anymore. At least ones I don't play.
I literally do not have games on my phone.
I still have games on my phone. I just don't touch any of them. Which yeah, I should probably get rid of them.
Yeah. Well, given that Nolan North has been in the voice acting industry and the video game industry for a while, and he is a video gamer, mm-hmm. I don't know. I got good hopes. He's someone who's seen the industry from the inside out, so I hope it goes well for him. Like, yeah.
I really don't have anything to say about this just because I only know Nolan North as a voice actor. So I can't really say anything when it comes to him making a game because I don't know what he's capable of in that aspect.
Well, he's not making the game. He's working with it.
Well, yeah, he's working with it. It says he is producing the game. He's acting as a producer. So I can't really say anything because A, I don't know I don't know Nolan North's capabilities in this field, and B, I don't even know what the fucking show is. I've never heard of it until I read this article.
You know what, man? Let's just give it the benefit of the doubt. That's what.
You know
what?
I hope it's good because it's got a grade A guy working on it, so I hope it ends up being good.
Let's just see. I mean, there's instances where that doesn't work out. There's instances where that does work out. So my guess is let's just see what happens.
All right. Moving off of that, speaking of Nolan North, Uncharted 4, when this comes out, came out yesterday, May 10th, and an article on EGM, Electronic Gaming Monthly, reads that the Uncharted 4 special editions are unboxed, including the limited edition PS4. As the article states, here's a first look at all three special editions of Uncharted 4, A Thief's End, including the Nathan Drake adorned 1 TB PlayStation 4. The Libertalia edition of Uncharted 4 includes a physical copy of the game in a steelbook case, a 48-page hardcover art book, a sticker kit, multiplayer content, and a 12-inch Nathan Drake statue. Meanwhile, the special edition includes everything in the Libertalia edition minus the statue. The special Uncharted 4 edition PlayStation 4 includes a 1 TB gray-blue PlayStation 4 featuring an image of Nathan Drake along with a matching controller. It's worth noting that the limited system comes with the standard edition of Uncharted 4. Uncharted 4 Thief's End launches May 10th, exclusive for PS4. And at the very end of the article, they talk about, you know, the fact that there was a few news stories a little earlier on in the month that people got the game early in the UK because of retailer disputes. But also, Sony came out and said that certain copies of the game were stolen.
Oh, boy.
I don't remember what game it was a couple years ago. They kind of had the same thing happen to it. But basically, a supply truck that was bringing the game to retailers got hijacked. And so that's the reason why people have Uncharted 4 early in the UK.
I think something similar actually happened in Paris when Modern Warfare 3 came out.
Yeah, I think it was Modern Warfare 3.
Yeah, because I remember reading about that.
Yeah, that supplier truck got raided and all the copies on board were stolen, which I think there were like 6,000 copies on that truck.
Interestingly enough, what happens in Paris in the game too is like kind of art imitating life, I guess, life imitating art.
So anyway, regardless, the story in general is talking about the limited editions of the game, which, Riley, what do you think about these limited editions now that I've broke it down for you? Do you think it'll be worth extra money?
Well, given that I have one and I did not pay for it because I got it for a Christmas gift, so it's going to be a little weirdly sided here, but here we go. I don't know. I mean, if somebody wants to get the system, which, admit it, the PS4 is a relatively new system, and so it's not like everybody has it. So
then again, it has already sold over 40 million units.
Yeah, true, but, you know, it's not like a PS2 where literally everyone in the world has one, pretty much. But even PS3 is starting to get there.
And plus, it's selling way more than the Xbox One right now.
Oh, yeah, big
like
time.
Their worldwide units sold is more than double of the Xbox.
Oh, hell yeah.
Which is unfortunate, because I feel like the Xbox has better games, but I digress.
We'll settle that at some point.
We will settle that at some point, but anyway, let's talk about the story in general. How do you feel about these special editions?
I like them. I know. Like, I'm not really big into collecting for game stuff, but I know some people are really into that. So
I think you would more than enjoy a Nathan Drake statue.
I absolutely would, but I don't have the money to show up for that right now. And I already have a PS4, so why the hell would I?
Keep in mind, this article doesn't name prices or anything, so I have no idea what these editions will actually cost.
Probably a bad sign that they don't name them.
Probably. But then again, by the time this episode comes out, the game will already be out, so everyone will already know. But I think, I don't know, like, it seems most of the time nowadays, special editions aren't really that special. Like,
Not really. Sure,
you get the game and maybe a steelbook case, you get some digital content, you get maybe a soundtrack, an art book. Most of the time, that's it. This doesn't seem all that much different other than the statue. The statue is really the main selling point of this special edition. But other than that, it just seems like your standard special edition for a game that comes out nowadays.
I have to agree, but
Like it comes with a steelbook, it comes with an art book, it comes with DLC, it comes with stickers, and it comes with a statue. Not that great, but still, I think Uncharted fans will be more than willing to pay for it.
Well, I love the Uncharted series, so, you know, if I had the money for that, and if I didn't have a PS4, I'd get it. So, that's me.
So, anyway. So, that's that. It's okay, but, you know, it could be better.
Let's just see.
Moving on, we have a new story involving Rockstar and Take Two.
Oh, yeah.
All right. It doesn't involve Red Dead, just letting you know.
I know.
Okay. As reported by EGM, Rockstar Games' parent company, Take-Two, files trademark for Judas. As the article states, Take-Two Interactive, and possibly Rockstar Games, is set to rustle some religious jimmies with a recent trademark filing for the name Judas.
Here we go.
DualShockers picked up the recent filing through the United States Patent and Trademark Office on behalf of Take-Two Interactive, the owners of Rockstar, 2K Games, and Firaxis Games. The name is filed under consideration for both game software and online game software, although a reading of the documents reveals no ties to any of the aforementioned subsidiaries. Also pointed out by DualShockers is the registration of domain name judasthegame.com under a registrar previously used by Take-Two Interactive. Anything should be considered pure speculation for now, but it's not difficult to imagine that the trademark be associated with Rockstar, given the company's history of exploring and making light of otherwise taboo subject matter.
Which we all know.
Yeah. So, Riley, what do you think about this? What do you think this could eventually lead to?
Probably a real shit show.
Oh, probably.
That's my first thought.
As if Rockstar doesn't need any more controversy over their fucking lifespan.
You know they thrive on
religion.
That, right? You know they thrive on that. It gets some good any publicity is good publicity.
Any publicity is good publicity.
So
what do you feel about this specifically? What do you think this Judas could become?
Maybe I highly doubt this, but maybe they're trying to redeem themselves a little bit, like make something that's, you know, like not too crazy. Like maybe, I don't know, I can't see Rockstar doing like a religion themed game. That'd be kind of weird. Like if you were to ask me when GTA 5 came out, Rockstar do a religion themed game, I'd just be like,
no.
Are you nuts?
Are you fucking stupid?
But who knows? Maybe it's just the name. Maybe the name is just Judas.
Yeah, maybe it's just the name. But it says in the article that it doesn't specify any particular religious things. It just says in the opening paragraph, Take-Two Interactive is set to rustle some religious jimmies with a trademark of Judas. it doesn't say anywhere else in the article about
maybe it's because of the name, any religious Judas's religious name.
Yeah, it doesn't say anything else in the article about possibly the game having religious ties, but it's just the name that's giving the speculation.
I don't know. I mean, it's hard to say.
Yeah, it's hard to say, seeing as how it's all speculation. We'll just have to see where this goes, if it goes anywhere. But I think if it is Rockstar, and it is them taking something a little more seriously than some of their other games, and trying to actually make, like, because they're obviously the masters of political and social satire.
Arguably, yeah.
So any real world, anything serious in the real world, they make fun of it. If this is a rare case of them actually taking something seriously and actually making it look good in the eyes of like a social view, then this could be something new from Rockstar. And we haven't really seen anything new from Rockstar in terms of a fresh experience since Red Dead.
So I don't know. Like, let's just see. Maybe they're trying to do a new IP. Maybe they're trying to. Maybe I get the feeling the name might just be Judas, just cause.
Yeah.
Just admit it. Rockstar is not exactly known for being conscious.
Yeah.
Of things, social issues. So maybe they're just doing this just to get people pissed off already, and you know, get attention for the game going now.
You
That's
never
my
take. We'll just have to see where that goes.
Who knows?
All right, moving on, we have a story coming from Microsoft and Xbox. As reported on Electronic Game Monthly, new Xbox One hardware might be showing up at E3, Microsoft Insider says.
So like a slim or something? Or
we'll see. The article reads, this year's E3 might bring us some big Xbox hardware announcements if a report from Microsoft blogger Brad Sams is to be believed. Sam published his report on a blog run by Paul Thurrott, the former senior technical analyst for Windows IT Pro. According to unnamed sources inside the company, Sam writes that we can expect to see a new Xbox One controller and some new hardware. That new hardware, according to Sam's, could be a new version of the Elite console or something else entirely. Either would probably be Microsoft's bid at competing with the upgraded rumored PlayStation 4.5 Sony's rumored to be bringing to the table, which there have been rumors lately about a new PlayStation 4 console called like PlayStation 4K or 4.5 that will have a 4K resolution output. Nothing's been confirmed by Microsoft or any official sources yet, so we'll just have to wait and see what comes out of E3. The expo runs from June 14th to June 16th of this year. So
let's just see what happens with that. I mean,
there's been a bunch of news lately coming from Microsoft that with an update that's coming soon. I don't know if it's already out at this point or if it's coming in the near future, that all Xbox Ones will eventually become development kits.
Really?
Yeah. They're releasing an update to make every Xbox One a development kit right from the get-go. And with this rumor that they might announce some new hardware, maybe they're taking that a step further. Maybe they're going to actually release specifically designed Xbox One development consoles. I don't know. What do you think? It could be just like a new Xbox One, like an Xbox One Slim or whatever, but it could be development consoles actually being released to the public. What do you think?
Maybe an Xbox 0.5? I don't know. Like, didn't Sony do that with the development kit thing? Like, I know they sent like their software as like a
it was never released like publicly.
Really?
Yeah, it was never released publicly. Microsoft, on the other hand, with this Xbox One update that's coming out, it's going to make every Xbox One a development kit,
which would make it easier for indie gamers.
Yeah, that's exactly why they're doing it. But with these rumors of new hardware being shown at E3, is it just an Xbox One Slim with like a bigger processor, more powerful, smaller model, or are they going to make actual development kits and release them in stores?
Well, who knows, man? Like, that'd be a good idea. Like, being able to have the software to make your own games, like, that'd be any indie gamer's dream.
Yeah.
Or any indie developer's dream, I guess. Mm-hmm. So, like, because we've seen it's not easy to do.
Not easy to do. Indie Game the Movie.
Good movie. On Netflix.
It's on Netflix. Watch it.
I don't have the copy you sent me a long time ago anymore.
I still have it.
Okay. Well,
but anyway, if you want to see what indie developers go through to actually get their games made, go watch Indie Game the Movie. It's on Netflix. You can download it, buy it on Blu-ray. That perfectly sums up indie game development. And now with this new development kit update for the Xbox One, it's going to make it way easier for indie developers to actually develop their games for the Xbox platform. But what is this new hardware going to be, if there's actually going to be new hardware?
Well, who knows? It might just be a slim version. They're just, again, you know, all news now is based on hype.
Yeah, maybe we're just overthinking it, but you never know.
I guarantee you we are. But who knows, man? Like, let's just see what happens.
Yeah, like, E3 isn't that far away. It's only a month away, and we're obviously going to be
It is a month away.
We're obviously going to be talking about it on the podcast.
Oh, when it comes up, we're going to obviously have some.
We're obviously, like, I know we didn't have an E3 special of the podcast last year. Then again, we didn't do much last year in terms of BGN in general. But I know 2013 and 2014, we did special episodes of the podcast where we talked about everything that happened at E3. We went over all the press conferences. So when E3 eventually shows up, and if there is new hardware being shown by Microsoft, we're obviously going to talk about it.
Yeah. Like, if it comes up, yeah, we're obviously going to discuss
it. We're going to talk about it. So we'll just have to wait and see what happens, which seems to be all the news stories today.
Let's see what happens type stories.
Yeah. We got a couple release dates to talk about. So last week on the podcast, me and Bones talked about there being a possibly another delay for Mighty No. 9, which is Keiji Inafune's game that he got funded through Kickstarter. It's basically a spiritual successor to Mega Man. It's a new generation of Mega Man. As reported by Electronic Game Monthly, Mighty No. 9 finally goes gold and locks in solid launch dates. The article says, following a sadly comical number of delays, the Mega Man-inspired platformer Mighty No. 9 has gone gold and will release next month. Creator Keiji Inafune confirmed the dates and announced gold status recently on the Mighty No. 9 website. Addressing fans, Inafune apologized for the multiple delays that the game had suffered and happily announced the game's finalized release dates as June 21st in the United States and June 24th worldwide. A quote coming from Inafune himself, with the game having gone gold, we are in the last final stages of being able to deliver it into your hands. Therefore, the release date we are announcing is set in stone and there will be no further delays for the game. Mighty No. 9 is available on PS4, Xbox One, PS3, Xbox 360, Wii U, 3DS, PS Vita, PC, Mac, Linux. It's on fucking everything.
Nintendo 64.
And it finally comes out June 21st. So after at least two or three delays for this fucking game that's been hyped to death on Kickstarter, it's being labeled as the new Mega Man. It's finally coming out next month. What do you think of this?
Well, man, I really haven't heard a heck of a lot about that, if I'm honest, because I don't like spend a long time like scouring news sites. Like if I hear tidbits about it here and there, I'm just like, oh, okay, cool.
Well, here's the thing. You're also not much of a Mega Man fan, am I correct?
Not particularly. Like,
yeah, so you probably haven't
appreciated for the games, but
you probably haven't been following this game like some other people.
No.
Because this is being made by the original creator of Mega Man. It's being helmed as the new era of Mega Man, even though it isn't technically a Mega Man game. Then again, Capcom isn't doing anything with Mega Man nowadays, so this might as well be.
Yeah, so
it's basically taking elements from the classic Mega Man series and the Mega Man X series and morphing them together into a new game. And now it's finally being released next month. What do you think?
I'd play it.
Well, you could get it on like three of your four systems.
Pretty much.
You could get it on your PS3, your PS4, your 3DS. You could get it on your Mac.
Even though I won't, because it's shit, and you probably won't be able to handle it.
You could literally get this game on every console you own.
Can I get it on PS2?
Probably.
There's probably ways.
So yeah, I'm excited. I've been hyped for this game ever since it was announced, because I myself am a Mega Man fan. And seeing that this was Keiji Inafune's new project, it's basically a spiritual successor to Mega Man. I've seen the gameplay. It looks great. I've been waiting to play this game for a while. It was supposed to come out back in September. And then it got delayed to February. And then it got delayed again. So I'm excited. I'm excited that this game is finally going to come out. And I'm going to play the hell out of it.
Awesome.
So anyway, well, moving on. We have another solid release date here. Riley, I don't remember last E3 if you remember the announcement of Dishonored 2.
Yeah, I know that.
Yeah. If Joe was here, he'd be fucking flipping out.
Yeah, he would, wouldn't he?
But as reported by EGM, Dishonored 2 release date announced. The article states, Dishonored 2, the sequel to Arkane Studios' hit stealth action game, will be released November 11th on the PS4, Xbox One, and PC. The release information was revealed over Bethesda's website. The publisher added that more information, including the world premiere of Dishonored 2's gameplay, will be revealed during their E3 press conference. Dishonored 2 features two main playable characters, Corvo Atano, the returning lead of the original Dishonored, and Emily Caldwin, who we saw last when she was still a young girl. It's basically the girl you had to save in the original game. She's now playable.
Sweet.
Bethesda's E3 conference takes place on June 12th, starting at 7 p.m. So yeah, Dishonored 2 finally has a solid release date a week after Call of Duty. Thank God it's not releasing on the same day as Call of Duty.
That would be bad.
But what do you think of this? I personally haven't played much of Dishonored, so I don't have much to say. I don't know if you're the same way, but
I've never played a Dishonored game.
Oh, well, there you go. But what do you think about this release date?
That close to a Call of Duty game is kind of, I don't know. I mean, it's not like it's a movie, like where, you know, it's in theaters for a certain amount of time and it goes out. Like, it'll be on shelves forever.
Yeah.
So, at least for like a couple years anyway, so.
Yeah, and like, we don't really know the solid release schedule of games coming out in the fourth quarter. So who's to say they couldn't push it up like a couple weeks before Call of Duty or a couple weeks after Call of Duty?
Who knows? Maybe it's just so the moms who, their 10-year-old kids are asking for Call of Duty, maybe they'll get them that instead.
We never know, but I'm glad that there's a solid release date and that they're going to show more at E3. I'm pretty sure the game's going to be cool because the first game kind of came out of nowhere and was like an instant hit.
Really?
Yeah, it just kind of came out of nowhere and people fell in love with it, and that's why a second game is even happening. So I'm excited to see what this game is going to bring, and it's being released in November, so that's cool.
Sweet.
All right, moving on to Ubisoft. There's some Ubisoft news. As reported by EGM, bear with me, possible leaked design of Watch Dogs 2 protagonist.
I heard about that.
Suggests,
yeah.
Aiden Pierce wasn't hipster enough. The article states, oh God, I see the photo now. Oh God.
Can you show it to the camera?
Oh God, no. Hold on. This guy.
The fuck, he looks like something out of Smash Brothers.
As the article states, the character design for Watch Dogs 2 protagonist may have been leaked by the character himself, or at the very least, the motion capture actor playing him. On the Instagram account of the King Court, an image of a cap and bandana clad nerd was posted with the tagline, "Had a blast doing motion capture work as the lead character in a new video game series." Smiling face. If the aggressive hipster style crossed with the unmistakable air of Aiden Pierce wasn't enough of a giveaway, the cascade of hashtags accompanying the post includes Watch Dogs 2. That said, there is seemingly nothing verifiable about the poster's claim. Take it with whatever grains of salt you currently have in your home. While variable sources, including publisher Ubisoft themselves, has confirmed the existence of Watch Dogs 2, no official announcement of the game has been made. An earnings report from earlier this year claims Watch Dogs 2 is expected to launch in this fiscal year, which implies that fans could get a glimpse of it at the upcoming E3. So what do you think about this?
I have a love-hate relationship with Watch Dogs. Like, I liked the concept, I just didn't feel it was done that well in the game. So who knows, maybe they'll learn from it.
The execution wasn't all that.
Well, then again, maybe it'll parallel what happened with the first Assassin's Creed to the second one. Like, the first one was...
I fucking hate the first Assassin's Creed.
But the second one is, like, one of the best games ever made, I'd argue.
I actually really like Watch Dogs, and I'm excited for a sequel because I know they can... There's nowhere to go but up, you know?
Yeah, I mean...
Like, they're going to do it better than they did before.
Obviously, they've had a lot of time to sort of regroup.
But if this story is correct, A, we've confirmed that Aiden Pierce is not returning as the main character. And B, we have a leaked photo of what could possibly be the new lead character, which I'll put up on screen for everyone to see.
Yeah.
What do you think of this? And first off, what do you think of his design?
Not digging it. He looks really kind of...
He looks too hipster for his own good.
Yeah, like a little bit. Like, Aiden Pierce was kind of a hipsterish kind of guy, but like...
I didn't get too much of a hipster vibe from Aiden all that much. I got more of an...
Typical video game anti-hero male.
Espionage, kind of. But yeah, with this guy, the hipster levels are through the fucking roof.
Yeah, I hear ya. Oh my god, why is everybody asking me to hang out now? Fuck.
Fuck, man. But yeah, what do you think about this?
I don't know. I mean, I'll give Watch Dogs 2 another chance because I liked the concept of Watch Dogs. I just didn't feel they did it well. So if they can do it well, I'm in. Also, I want to address something. Leaks are not leaks anymore. Now it's just like people like just like, okay, we're going to leak the data on this date. It's like they leak to get publicity.
Yeah.
It's like now it's intentional now. Now it's just not the same. Like back in the day when a leak of a game came out, it was like, oh my god. It was like finding like a, as my dad put it, it was like finding a Playboy in an old field.
Your dad is the best.
I know.
But anyway, okay. A couple questions I have for you then. A, do you think that this guy is going to replace Aiden Pierce as the main character?
Maybe. Maybe not. Maybe he's just sort of a side character. Maybe it's like a two-character thing, because ever since GTA 5, a multi-character
You never know. Like, maybe they'll do the whole dual protagonist thing. You never know.
Well, because they did that with the last Assassin's Creed, didn't they?
Yeah, they did.
Which I haven't played, so I can't say it. But
B, do you think if this guy does replace Aiden, do you think Aiden will be in the game at all? Like, will he be a cameo or will he be a supporting character? What do you think Aiden's role will be in the sequel?
If he won't be a supporting character, he'll have a cameo appearance or like a hidden appearance you have to find, like Aisha Tyler's character.
No. Oh, yeah, probably.
Which I still think is funny.
And C, do you think they're going? Do you think that they will either announce this game this year, E3, or that it will come out by the end of the year? I think
it might be a bit too soon. I'd say next year.
I think next year at the earliest.
Like, I remember the game came out in April of...
No, it came out in May. It came out at the end of May 2 years ago.
Oh, yeah, right, because, yeah.
It came out just after my birthday.
Yippee.
So,
and,
yeah.
Let's just see what happens. Oh, my God. We'll stop messaging me, people. Sorry.
Throw your phone away.
Fuck's sakes. I miss... Times like this, I miss the times I used to have no friends.
Yeah.
Genuinely.
But anyway, I think I'm not sure if they'll replace Aiden because I think Aiden has a lot of potential left in him to be a really good character. I personally like this character, but there's definitely more they could do with him. So I don't think they're done with him just yet. If they are replacing him, I hope they do this new character justice and he's not just, you know, an interchangeable fucking generic protagonist.
Because we see that a lot in games lately, and I don't know how I feel about that.
And in terms of the game coming out, I think this year is a little too early. Like, early next year. Early next year at the latest, maybe second quarter.
Fall.
Yeah, maybe second quarter, third quarter next year. But I think they are going to announce something at E3.
Okay, well, if they announce something, as a release date, I would say probably summer to fall of next year.
We will just have to play it by ear. So anyway. Moving on, we have a story about From Software, the developers behind Dark Souls and Bloodborne, as reported by EGM. From Software's next project may be coming to PlayStation VR.
Really?
PlayStation Virtual Reality. The article states, a new video from Software's original YouTube channel... their official YouTube channel hints that the developer's next game will be released on PlayStation VR sometime in 2017. The unlisted video explores the company's 19-year history and gives a very brief look at the Dark Souls 3 developer's plan for the future. Text notes from From Software's next title will release on PlayStation 4, Xbox One, PC, and PlayStation VR. If the game is coming to PC, then it's likely to support Oculus Rift and HTC Vive in addition to Sony's head-mounted display. It's safe to assume that we weren't meant to see this clip. There is no sound, and its obvious placeholder title, From Software, _ lineup for Recruit, misspells the studio's name. Oh, it's From Software, not From Software.
Software. Oh my gosh.
You might want to watch this one soon before it gets taken down. From Software's president hit a... I'm going to butcher this name. I'm sorry.
Just spell it out when you do the video.
Hidetaka Miyazaki. Hidetaka Miyazaki recently said that there are currently absolutely no plan right now for any sequel spinoffs or tie-ins, stating that the Soul series is officially over and anything to come from the developer is completely new IP. So what do you think about this? First off, what do you think the game is going to be based on who's developing it?
I don't know, man. Like, I'm trying to think here, and
Like, if they say that they're not focusing on any spin-offs or sequels or any continuations of their old series. A new IP, maybe. They've come out and blatantly said that Dark Souls is pretty much over after 3. So whatever new game they do, would it be a different style? Would it still be in the style of Dark Souls like Bloodborne was, or will it be something completely new?
Who knows? Maybe they might keep their style. Maybe they might try something different. Who knows?
Who knows?
Like,
but
you never know with games anymore.
Yeah. Like, what do you think about this game possibly coming to virtual reality?
That'd be fucking sick, even though I'd probably get sick just doing it.
Oh, yeah, probably. I've seen videos of the Oculus Rift, and it's like, what?
I've seen people play Slender on there, and I'm just like, I don't need high blood pressure at the age of 20. I'm 20. I don't need high blood pressure.
Yeah, okay. So what do you think about this game? Whatever it could be.
I'd say let's wait till we get more further information coming out, and we'll see what happens from there.
I think it could be interesting because it seems that From Software is a very unique developer to begin with. Like, Dark Souls kind of came out of nowhere and took the world by storm.
Yeah.
So in the span of not even a decade, these guys have basically become like world renowned in the industry. So with their style of game coming to a virtual reality platform, I think that could be something really interesting and really unique. But until we hear an official announcement or any more details, we kind of have to wait and see.
Yeah. So our
last 5 stories here are all based on Call of Duty Infinite Warfare.
Also, Shane, real fast, I have to leave at a little after 2 to go to the mall to get a Mother's Day present, so...
That's okay. We're wrapping up really soon.
Okay, good.
Our last few stories here are based on Infinite Warfare, seeing as how it just got announced. There's a bunch of news coming out about this game. First off, Infinite Warfare is current gen only. As reported by IGN, it looks like Call of Duty Infinite Warfare won't be coming to PlayStation 3 or Xbox 360. In response to a fan question on Twitter, the official Infinity Ward account announced the game will not be on PS3. There is no mention of Xbox 360, but it's safe to assume it's not coming to that one either. Last year's Black Ops 3 didn't have a campaign mode on previous gen platforms. Recently, back in April, Microsoft announced that they're discontinuing production of the Xbox 360. Infinite Warfare was just announced. So what do you think about this? I personally think it's a good thing because Black Ops 3 shouldn't have been on last-gen platforms to begin with because it was completely butchered.
It was definitely not what it could have been.
Because it didn't have a campaign. It didn't have a zombies campaign. It just had your standard zombies and your standard multiplayer, and it was completely butchered. Like, the graphics sucked, the sound sucked. They shouldn't have even bothered to begin with.
Exactly. I wholeheartedly agree.
So I think this is a good thing, personally, because I think the quality of the game will go up rather than them having to...
They have so much more to work with now.
Yeah,
like,
rather than them having to put resources and materials into making an inferior last-gen version. So I think it's... It is kind of a waste of time at this point, but I think it's a good thing. What do you think?
Well, then again, you know what? Do we have to say new gen? I mean, I think we can go with current gen
and current last gen.
Because, like, it's been 2 years now, so we can kind of go back into it. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. I think it's a good move because, you know, it's the last gen had its run. Like, now it's time to move on.
It's definitely time to move on.
It's like ripping off a Band-Aid, you know?
All right, going off of that, we have a story from EGM stating that there is no co-op support for Infinity Ward's campaign. Yeah, Infinite Warfare's campaign. The article states, Activision has confirmed that Call of Duty Infinite Warfare's campaign will be single-player only. The publisher informed Video Gamer that there will be no co-op support for the game's main campaign, but Zombies Mode will still support co-op. Infinite Warfare's campaign takes the series to the stars with dogfight, space combat, and zero gravity. However, Infinite Warfare's design director, Jacob Minkoff, stated that it will be the most grounded, believable conflict that you could possibly have in space. Basically, unlike Black Ops 3 last year, which was a 4-player co-op campaign, this year's COD Infinite Warfare's campaign will be single player only. What do you think?
Well,
I think we're so used to Call of Duty campaigns being single player only that it's not that much of a change.
Yeah, like, I have to agree with that.
It's nothing that surprising, even though they did go against the norm last year with Black Ops 3, which did have 4-player co-op campaign. But most COD games most Call of Duty games campaigns are single player only. So I'm not that surprised. What about you?
It's definitely a change for the Call of Duty series, I have to admit. I don't know. As I've said, Call of Duty is not a series I particularly care for anymore, but like, I know a lot of people obviously still do because it's still bought in droves every time a new one comes out, which I don't know how the hell people do that, but you know.
I personally think this one would have warranted better for a co-op campaign, seeing as how it is being, there is space combat, you know, with the dogfights, and you're actually like in space.
I feel like it's become too much like Halo now, if I'm honest.
Then again, Halo has become too much like Call of Duty now, so.
Sorry if you, they might as well just put the names on the other packaging, eh?
Yeah, but I think this game would have benefited from a co-op campaign, but it doesn't surprise me that it doesn't have one.
Well.
Alrighty, moving on here. Our two last stories revolve around not Infinite Warfare, but Modern Warfare Remastered.
Yeah.
Which, we're going to have the positive story first off. Because there's one that's a little more negative that we'll get to.
Positive or?
Oh, there's one that's not as great news, but we'll get to that one later. First off, we have a story from EGM. Call of Duty Modern Warfare Remastered will feature completely new audio, textures, and more. Basically, they're making this remaster from the ground up. As the article states, developer Infinity Ward revealed during the announcement livestream that Call of Duty Modern Warfare Remastered will feature completely new audio and textures. Eric Monticelli, Infinity Ward's director of communications, said that the remastering's developer, Raven Software, will rework the game from many different angles. A quote, "Raven's really amping everything up. The studio is sticking true to the core original vision of the game, but they're looking back at the textures and reworking those completely from the ground up to make them have that fidelity that you expect from current console generations. It's going to look vibrant, it's going to look brilliant, it's going to look like something amazing when you play this game. The audio is also getting a second look and will feature newly recorded sounds." Another quote. "These sounds are being completely reworked. There's audio reworking done. We've revamped all of that. There's new Foley that was recorded." Basically, the nine-year-old game, the remaster is being built from the ground up. So this is very similar to what 343 Industries did with Halo Anniversary, where the game itself is running on the same engine as the original, but they completely redid all the audio and visual from scratch, making it look completely different. And there are actually some videos and photos. I'll put some photos up on the screen so everyone can see comparison shots between the original game back in 2007 and the remaster that's coming out this year. And it looks like a completely new game. The game is going to look amazing. So what do you think about the effort that they're putting into this remaster?
Well, I noticed remasters are becoming a trend lately. Like, there's, I'm seeing a lot of them now, actually. Like, Uncharted. I guess you could argue Ratchet and Clank. But that's sort of a new thing.
Reimagining, because it's a completely new game just based on the original. But yeah, I see what you're saying.
I don't know. I like remasterings because it gives you a chance to experience something that you either have never played before or had a lot of good memories playing before, like me with the original Call of Duty 4.
Mm-hmm.
God, I miss that game.
Still my favorite COD.
It still holds up. Like, it's going to be 10 years old. 10 years old next year. What the fuck?
Yeah. Which, it kind of doesn't make sense that they would release the remaster this year. Because next year's the 10th anniversary.
Do it next. I would have no problems waiting for it next year if it could be like 10th anniversary edition. It would make more sense. Like,
it would make a hell of a lot more sense.
Nobody gives a shit about a couple's 9-year anniversary. We give a shit about their 10-year anniversary.
Yeah. But yeah, I think that the amount of effort that they're putting into this is really, really promising, because I'll even show you some of the photos later on when you have time to look at them. Like, the work they've done on this is amazing. Like, everything, you can tell it's still COD 4, but it looks completely new. And like, again, I made the comparison to Halo Anniversary. 343 did the same thing when they did the Halo Anniversary back in 2011. They redid all the visuals and all the audio, and it benefited greatly from that. So this isn't just your run-of-the-mill, oh, we're going to bump up the resolution and the frame rate, and we're just going to release the same game again on a new console. They're basically making a new game from the ground up, and I give them nothing but credit for that, and I think the game is going to shine.
I agree.
But going off of that, we have a not-so-great news story. As reported by EGM, the only way to get Modern Warfare Remastered is through the collector's editions of Infinite Warfare. As the article states...
You can hear me punching that wall because that's a really stupid thing.
Calm down, Riley. As the article states, those wanting Call of Duty Modern Warfare Remastered will have to purchase a collector's edition of Infinite Warfare. On Activision's support page, the company states that there are currently no plans to make the remaster game available for individual purchase, meaning the only way to acquire it is to purchase specific versions of Infinite Warfare. A quote, Call of Duty Modern Warfare Remastered is only available through the Legacy, Legacy Pro, and Digital Deluxe editions of Infinite Warfare. You must own Infinite Warfare in order to get Modern Warfare Remastered. The Legacy, Digital Deluxe, and Legacy Pro editions retail for $80, $100, and $120 respectively. The remastered version of Modern Warfare includes the game's campaign mode along with 10 of the original game's maps. And it's being released with Infinite Warfare. This is bullshit.
A little bit. Like,
this
we've
is
already
complete
mentioned
bullshit.
Stuff.
And, like, Bones and I talked about this last week when we were going over the rumors and stuff, because we found a supposed reservation card from Target that said the Legacy Edition includes Modern Warfare Remastered. And we thought, well, does that mean that they're going to release it individually if it is true, or can you only get it through this upgraded version? And they come out and said, yeah, we're not releasing it individually. You have to buy Infinite Warfare to get it. What do you think?
As I mentioned before, that's a fucking ripoff almost.
It's bad business. Like, really.
It's like, what are you doing, man? You just, like, you're making me shell all this money? Fuck
just
you.
Imagine. Okay. Well, I've heard that. Okay, so the Legacy Edition, which is basically the retail version, it's normal retail price. It's $80, right? Mm-hmm. It would make way more sense to release Modern Warfare Remastered individually for like $20, maybe even $30. Alongside Infinite Warfare, which is still standard $80 price. You'd be making way more money. Like, not everyone is going to buy your super deluxe expensive editions of the game.
How about you? I can't afford that.
No. Like, you release the Modern Warfare remaster on its own for $30, and you still have Infinite Warfare going for $80. You would make way more money. Like, this is just bad business.
Yeah, like,
also, what the fuck are you doing on that?
What do you mean?
I hear like a crack.
Oh, sorry.
You
sorry,
bitch.
Was it bad?
It was very bad.
Oh, sorry about that. It fell out of my ear and it was sort of going against my shirt.
Yeah, no problem. But, oh yeah, because I forgot the mic is in your headphones, right?
Yeah, it's right here. See?
Yeah, okay. But anyway, so what are your final thoughts on this? And like, what is your opinion? Give me your random Richard opinion on this.
Random Richard opinion. I haven't heard that in a long time. No kidding. Fuck this.
Yeah.
This is a waste of money. They're not getting a dime of my money. In fact, I am going to literally take a dime out of there and then not give it to them just to spite them.
I just, like I said, it's bad business. You can make way more money and get way more sales by releasing it individually along with the actual game itself.
But no.
But no. You have to buy the special editions of the game to get it. Even though the Legacy Edition is basically just a standard retail edition, you could still make way more money if you release this on its own.
Yeah,
like just imagine someone buys Infinite Warfare because, like me, they're hyped for it and they want to see if it's like anything new. They buy it for $80 plus tax, and then they buy Modern Warfare Remaster for $30 plus tax digitally because they either haven't played it or they have nostalgia for it. How much more money could you make doing that?
Well, clearly their heads aren't screwed on properly.
Then again, it is Activision, so.
Fair enough. So that's kind of fucking par for the course there, don't you think?
Also, this seems kind of contradictory because there was a story that came out either a week or two ago that said that there was a sighting of a Modern Warfare trilogy bundle on Amazon. Like there
I haven't heard anything about that.
Yeah, there was a sighting on Amazon for a Modern Warfare Remastered Trilogy bundle on, you know, Xbox One, PS4. So if that bundle ends up being real and that gets announced, like, oh, we're going to release a trilogy bundle of all three Modern Warfare games remastered for the current generation platforms, and we're going to release that separately. What's even the point of doing the Modern Warfare Remastered with Infinite Warfare thing if that's going to end up being true?
Like, I don't have anything to say about that because that's just ridiculous.
It is actually ridiculous. Like,
this is making me really not like Call of Duty more.
More so than you already didn't.
Well, I don't hate Call of Duty. I like the older ones. Just the newer ones,
Like, okay.
Excuse me. I don't care.
Like, think about this. If that sighting is real and that ends up being a real thing, the Modern Warfare trilogy, all three Modern Warfare games remastered for the current gen, you could buy it for Xbox One, PS4. You get all three Modern Warfare games. What's even the point of doing this? What's even the point of doing just the Modern Warfare remaster thing and only making it available with Infinite Warfare? You can make way more money later on if you do the trilogy.
But clearly, you
know... Again, this is bad business.
And well, like, then again, it's Activision. As we mentioned,
it is Activision.
You don't exactly hear Activision and good business practices in the same sentence.
Well, like, people have been wanting the Modern Warfare games remastered for years. You have the perfect opportunity to do this. If that ends up being real, then this is completely pointless. This whole Modern Warfare remaster thing, Infinite Warfare thing, it's completely pointless.
Then, but, yeah, why do that when I can just get the collector's edition?
Yeah, why do that when you can get all three games bundled together, remastered? Even if that remaster, even if that trilogy bundle isn't real, it would still make more sense to release Modern Warfare Remastered individually, and that way you can make more money, and that way you don't isolate your fan base. Because not everyone is going to want to buy Infinite Warfare, but I'm sure a lot more people are going to want to buy Modern Warfare Remastered than Infinite Warfare. They have to buy the new game to be able to get that, and that's just not a good thing.
Which I don't want. I want the original Modern Warfare, which I loved.
Yeah.
Well, so, 1 and 3.
Yeah. So someone like you who just wants Modern Warfare Remastered and doesn't want anything to do with Infinite Warfare, you're shit out of luck. You're shit out of luck, bro.
Might as well just pop it. Oh, given that I have it on PS3, it's not a super big deal, but I get your point.
Deal, but yeah, still. It would be interesting to go back and see, like all remasters, it would be interesting to go back to a game you love and see it in the modern day with modern graphics, just to see how far that game has come, right?
Because even if you, like, I will admit, like, from the first Modern Warfare, the graphics are obviously dated, mm-hmm. but it still looks good. Yeah. Like, it's not great, obviously, but it looks good.
Yeah, like, it's just bad business on Activision's part. Like, they could sell it separately and make way more money, or they could just not bother, do a trilogy bundle, a remastered trilogy later on, and make way more money like that. You could sell that for like $60 and no one would complain.
$60 for three games? Fuck yeah, I'm in.
Yeah. You like, I should work for Activision.
I should become I should work in their marketing, shouldn't
like,
I?
I should work in their marketing department. But anyway, final thoughts on this, Riley?
I think we've established this enough that it's fucking gay.
It's fucking dumb. Like, if there is going to be a trilogy bundle later on, I'm just going to wait for that. I'm probably going to end up getting Infinite Warfare at some point anyway because I'm interested.
I will not.
I'm interested to see what they're going to do with it. So it doesn't really affect me, but it affects people who don't care about Infinite Warfare but do care about Modern Warfare.
Me.
Yeah. Like, see, it doesn't affect me, but it affects others, and that's why it's a bad thing.
Agreed.
So if they do release a trilogy bundle at some point later on in the future, I will definitely get that.
Well, yeah, definitely the Modern Warfare bundle. Like, first off, that'd be awesome. Remastered? Yeah. Oh.
Like, if they put the same amount of effort that they're doing with Modern Warfare Remastered, then I'm all for it.
I agree. But...
So, anything else you want to say before we wrap things up here?
Kind of good for right now. First off, it's good to be back. I like coming back here.
Yeah, it's great to have you back. I know it's been a long time coming. Like, you've been off the channel for almost 2 years.
But I haven't been anywhere. Like, we've still seen each other a lot.
Yeah, you and I have still, like, kept in touch. It's just you haven't been present. You haven't been present on the channel in a long time.
And, of course, the instant I decide to get back into it, my life suddenly gets a hell of a lot more busier. So
yeah, apparently.
Go figure.
But, Riley, it's good to have you back. I hope
you too,
that...
man.
I haven't gone anywhere.
What do you mean you haven't gone anywhere?
I haven't gone anywhere.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
But anyway,
yeah, you've been here the whole time.
Yeah. I've been running the show, man. By myself.
Basically.
But
I don't have the experience or the skills or the patience to deal with that or the time.
Yeah. But Riley, it's great to have you back.
You too, man.
I look forward to doing a podcast every week from here on out. It's going to be some great stuff. I hope to get you on some of the Let's Plays or the live streams in the future, which will be a lot of fun. And
thank you.
Overall, I'm excited now that you're back. What the future of BGN holds for us.
I do want to address that, given my life's getting kind of complicated, I may not be able to do it every Wednesday.
Yeah, I understand that, but okay. Most weeks out of, more so than not, you'll be on the show.
Yeah, like, we can always just do it, like, another day in the week, like.
Yeah, but anyway, enough babbling, let's wrap this up. So, thank you very much for watching episode 36 of the Bearded Banter Podcast. If you like what you've seen,
holy shit.
If you like what you've seen, you can subscribe to BGN down below. You can subscribe to our YouTube channel. A new episode of the Bearded Banter Podcast will be live on BGN every Wednesday. And with that said, we're going to wrap things up. So thank you very much for watching, and we will see you next week. I have been your host, The Bearded One. With me was my co-host, Random Richard.
Have a good one, everyone. Good to be back.
And we will see you next week for a very special episode. Keep on gaming, everyone.
Okay. Bye-bye, everyone.